Beginning on October 2nd, residents of unincorporated Polk County will notice improvements in their waste and recycling services. Polk County Waste and Recycling values their customers, and they are committed to making these transitions as seamless as possible. Find out how right here. You're watching Polk Waste Wise.
Hello and welcome to Polk Waste Wise, the show where we bring you up to date on all things related to your Polk County Waste and Recycling services. It's been a few months since the new services kicked off in October, and now the holidays are right around the corner, so there's a few things that you may want to know as they come closer. Today, I welcome again Ms. Anna Wood, the Director of Polk County Waste and Recycling, to give an update on what's been happening since October 2nd and what you can expect in the coming months. Hey, Anna, how's it going?
Hello, how you doing?
I'm doing well.
Well, thank you for having me back. It seems like yesterday that we were taping, and it's already 2 months
since
the new contract started. A lot of new things have been happening. First of all, the hurricane brought a lot of new opportunities and challenges to our waste and recycling division, as well as to our customers. Since the last time we taped the last show, we have been very active delivering the recycling carts. Mm-hmm. To date, we have delivered over 58,000 of them. 45,000 were delivered prior to October 2nd. Mm-hmm. And as residents are requesting more and more, we are actually delivering more carts to our residents.
That's great to hear.
Yes.
So I understand you're still getting a good amount of requests for these carts, correct?
Yes. We are actually getting approximately 200 daily requests.
Wow.
New requests for the cart. When we started the program, our understanding based on historical data, the information that we had, approximately 35-40% of the population participated in the recycling program. That equated like around 35,000. Mm-hmm. Right now we are close to 70,000 participants. Wow. Almost half of our customer base, which is 140,000. Mm-hmm. So we are riding the carts as quickly as we possibly can. We have the vendor delivering carts. We also have the county contractor, a separate contractor, to keep up with the demand from our residents to ensure that we provide them the carts in a timely manner.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys have an approximate timeline that you're looking at with the people who have requested carts, if they're still waiting on them?
Yeah, we have approximately 12,000 new requests.
Wow.
And our expectation is to have everything delivered before December 23rd. Okay. So we work in Saturdays, Monday through Saturday, delivering carts and routing as many as possible to ensure that come December 23rd, everybody will have the cart and they can actually use it with all the packaging from the Christmas cardboard.
Yes.
And the papers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's important because they are going to have a ton of extra waste, for lack of better words, to get rid of at the holidays.
Yeah, this is one campaign, for during the holidays that we want to see the weight of the carts go up.
Yes, absolutely.
We need a healthy diet.
For sure.
Yes.
So when we're talking about these carts going up in weight for the holidays, let's talk about what is accepted in these carts. We've talked about it before, but let's reiterate it for the holiday season.
Yes, we want healthy weight, as good nutritional items for the recycling cart. So if you can help me out, we can start putting it in there and showing the residents.
Absolutely.
What do you do? And the first one is the aluminum can. Aluminum cans are very good. This is one of the best diets for this recycling cart. As many residents already know, that stays in the United States and is recycled here in the United States. The second one are the plastics.
All right. And this is our opaque plastics, right?
Translucent. It's called translucent, yeah.
Okay.
Kind of that kind of plastic. Different shapes, as you can see, we have a different shape. It's that type of plastic, color type of plastic that we accept. And obviously the metal cans from, yes, that is very good too. We have more cardboard, yes. And the only actually product that should be going into this bin, most of everything is packaging. That's what we do. Mm-hmm. Is the newspaper. This is the only item that you typically will buy and you will use. This is the product that you buy in. So newspaper is the only exception where you actually will put the product into the recycling cart. The mm-hmm. rest is all packaging.
So when you're talking about product and packaging, mm-hmm. you've talked before in a presentation you did recently that we'll get to in a second, about how you wouldn't put a hose into your recycle cart. So just be a little bit more specific about what product is versus packaging and what belongs here.
That's a very good question. Some residents see a hose being plastic, Robert, and they want to put it in here. So the way to kind of differentiate what goes in here is actually if we see that you're not buying, per se, the thin can that I'm holding in my hand. Mm-hmm. You're buying the content that is inside. So the product itself, we don't need inside the cart. Mm-hmm. We need the external packaging. The same with the cereal box. You're not buying, per se, the cardboard box that the cereal is on. Mm-hmm. You're buying the cereal that you will be eating. So the packaging is what we need. And if we keep that kind of concept, we will minimize any type of contamination or cross-contamination inside the recycling cart. Like I mentioned to you before, newspaper is actually the only product, per se, that you actually buy in, and it's not packaging, mm-hmm. it's the product itself that we recycled in the recycling cart.
Mm-hmm. Now, is that the best rule of thumb because you say people think of the hose as rubber or plastic, but we don't know what combination of plastics is in there? Is that why we're avoiding the product and sticking with the packaging?
Well, it is because curbside recycling, the products that have value or that we're marketing or selling is actually the cardboard, not the hose per se. That doesn't have any value when it comes to the recycling product. Another way to look at it is if you apply the same concept to paper plates after they've been used, those are not the cardboard that you or the product that you want to put in here. Many people think that if that a paper plate is made of paper and after it's been used, they're going to put it in here. No, that belongs in your garbage container.
So I just mentioned a minute ago about a presentation that you did. Mm-hmm. It was in the commissioner's meeting last month in November, and I'd like to give you a little condensed version of that presentation for those who maybe didn't see it when you did the full-blown one. So can you give kind of a summary of what you talked about there?
Yes, the purpose of that presentation was to establish a common denominator, a common language with our customers and residents of what is recycling, what's actually recycling. When I ask people, when people talk to me very passionately about recycling, they tell me I recycled. So I've noticed that there is a direct connection of what recycling is. Many people don't have a clear vision of what that is. Mm-hmm. So we show the process, a condensed process of where do we actually inject ourselves into the recycling circle.
Right.
And typically we as consumers become in contact with recycling when we consume a product, when we buy something. Mm-hmm. And that is the time where we buy it, we consume the product, we have the packaging, and we put it in here. At that time, you know, residents put the materials in cart, roll it to the curb, and they pretty much stop thinking about what happens to the content.
Right.
And then from there, though, you know, the truck will get it, the truck will pick it up at the curb, it will take that material into a recovery facility is a building with machinery and people that sort through all of this packaging. Mm-hmm. And they are sorting by type and removing any contaminants that may be in that product. And then from there, it has to go to a broker, somebody who has a buyer that is interested in this process or in this material, and then it goes to the buyer who's gonna use it. The buyer at the same time is making a decision based on price. Should they be buying post-consumer or secondary materials, or should they be going into virgin material? In the case of plastic, it's an easy answer. It's either you're doing with petroleum base, virgin petroleum, or are you gonna be using post-consumer plastic? From there, it goes to the manufacturing. And the manufacturer actually processes whatever materials they need to make whatever packaging they need to make. And sometimes out of the packaging material will become a product. Like many people tell me that there is plastic lumber that is recycled, plastic is recycled into.
Oh.
So that is a product. That product, you cannot put pieces of that product inside the cart. just because came from plastic.
Right.
That's a totally different type of material. So it is, it's a kind of a complex system, and we simplify it by the image that you are seeing now, where it shows the process and where we are.
So Anna, in your presentation, you mentioned something called the magic cart myth. Tell me about that, because that kind of simplifies the idea that people have about this process.
Yes, when we go shopping and we bring all our products and then we have all the packaging, people just, happily put everything in here, mm-hmm. things that are not recycling, like right. this packaging, or this one here. So they can put all this packaging into here, and then magically,
they think
this is a magic cart because out comes something of use from there.
Right.
So for this actually to happen, we have to have the right materials into the cart.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, this will end up in somebody else's landfills or polluting the landscape.
Right.
And that is one of the reasons it's so critical for us to understand what goes in, and that is not a magic cart. That myth is, it has been there for a while, and we need to ensure that our residents understand the process and when do we actually get something out of it.
Mm-hmm. And now I was talking to you off camera, and you mentioned also that with certain materials that can go in there, for instance, or cannot go in there, for instance, glossy magazines, mm-hmm. that type of paper can't go in there, but they can reuse.
Oh yes, so as many of our residents know, the pyramid of the environment is reuse, reduce, recycle.
Mm-hmm.
And reusing is a key component of the process. And we in Polk County have several outlets where we can take magazines. One that I do use personally is the Friends of the Library. They will take you magazines and they also sell them. People go in there and buy them and they're for projects or to read them, and it creates funds for the library system.
Mm-hmm.
Other places are the Goodwill stores will take them, and some of the vintage stores that specialize in magazines and books,
mm-hmm.
they'd be more than happy to take magazines that residents have, and they will actually sell it back. So we actually helping the economy as well.
Well, your presentation was much more extensive than that and very educational. You had some professionals on the matter come in and give their insight too. And if the residents didn't catch the presentation, they can catch it on our website. It's www.polk-county.net/PGTV. You'll find it on there in the Board of County Commissioners section under November. So they can check that out and get a little bit more insight
yes.
on this topic.
And one of the speakers was Dr. Townsend from the University of Florida,
mm-hmm.
who gave a very comprehensive history of the recycling in the state of Florida and where it's going as well, which changes are coming, as we all know.
So we've talked a lot about what can go in the recycle carts, but how else can residents find that information? How can they physically see what can go in?
Good. One of the things that approaches that we took is that we actually imprinted the materials that go into the lid here.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to this, we also have it in our website, which is actually pictures that can that the resident or the customer can see and then see the packaging and comparing it to that.
Mm-hmm. Now, if they look at this picture and they kind of disregard it and they continue to put products in here or materials in here that are not a part of this,
mm-hmm.
What is the big impact that has on the county and the
program itself?
On the program as a whole.
Well, the impact is I just want to demonstrate what we do at Waste and Recycling and how when residents hear about the words like contamination, mm-hmm. cross-contamination, and we hear about devaluing or it doesn't have the value and quality, and a lot of people think, what are they talking about?
Right.
The best way to describe it is the quality of the product is determined by the type of materials that we are collecting and how they're being reused to make either products or new packaging.
Mm-hmm.
And how we do that is we physically, when the truck comes into the recovery facility, we literally go in and audit, look at loads, samples, you know, we randomly select samples and we looked at the content of that load. Like this type of material, foam, packaging, you know, typically takeout foods. This is not a packaging material that we collect in our program. This is a no-no. This is actually contamination when you put it in the bin. So based on the content, we know what percentage of the load was aluminum, what percentage of the load was the actually plastic that we collect, the paper, and what percentage were either cross-contamination or contaminants. A contaminant will be like glass. Glass will make the load unusable to a degree.
Right.
So then you have cross-contamination. Cross-contamination is when people who are very eager to recycle every plastic, they say, well, this is plastic and this is plastic, let's put it together. So that is cross-contamination because that second plastic doesn't have, is not destined to be recycled. It's destined to go into a landfill. And the buyer is not willing to buy cross-contamination because this is what they're looking for to make that product. And that's what we do. We look at the loads, we put in percentages, how much does it weigh, you know, what percentage of that load is plastic, aluminum, and based on that, the impact to Polk County is based on that, is how we sell the products. So if we have, if when we do the audit or the survey, we have a lot of contamination, a lot of garbage in there, we're devaluing, we're not getting the most for our products, environmentally, we're sending a signal that our product, that we are, the materials, you know, that we are sending, don't have the quality and don't meet the need of the potential buyer. So our material is not as desirable as other materials. And that is the key. And from a collection standpoint, trucks have cameras. And whenever the driver takes that the cart and puts it inside the hopper or the inside the truck, we have a camera that is recording the type of materials that are going into the cart. And that is how we will be determine which areas are bringing the contamination. We may not know that is on a wood, right, but I know it's in that area, and then we will narrow it down and eventually go to the customer and talk to the customer and ask the customer not to be putting materials or packaging that is not that is outside the scope of our program.
Well, we're going to take a break from recycling and take a quick break. When we come back, we'll shift gears to garbage.
Okay,
so
thank
stay
you.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
We are a custom contract manufacturer, and we do handle all different types of materials. Thermoplastics, fluoropolymers are really our niche. We do the compounds where we do the coloring for ourselves internally, and as we sell compounds as well for people that are making tubing. So we take the natural material and then we add pigments to it and be able to put radiopaque fillers in there as well, so you can see them under x-rays and the whole nine yards.
And all of these materials that we have are from virgin materials. They don't have post-consumer plastics, so nothing.
No, absolutely, yeah. All virgin materials, especially with being in the medical industry, that's we have to use the virgin material.
The interesting portion about this is it's two-shot, so two-component material molded out of a polypropylene substrate and then a TPE over-molded. So it starts off as two virgin resins and then comes out as a single material, so it's not post-consumer. However, any extra material gets reground and reused to make the correct.
Okay.
Yeah, so any of the waste gets reused to make more.
So we are a quick turn manufacturer. We specialize in 3D printing, CNC machining, and injection molding. All around us you have examples of the plastic components that we produce, and we do have thousands of readily available plastics that we can utilize for each service. What we have in front of us right here, for example, is a plastic component. More specifically, this has been CNC machined from Delrin, and this is virgin material. As is any other plastic part you'll find coming from our facilities, we exclusively use virgin material in our parts. So it's very important for us and for many manufacturers to be able to know exactly what is in the plastics that we're producing. We're non-industry specific, so a majority of our customers do really care about exactly what is in that material that we're producing in their parts. Beyond that, once you get past like the chemical makeup of the part, it is very important that most of our parts don't have any sort of blemish or cosmetic defects in the part. So that's why, from my understanding, we use virgin material.
Yes, the 3D printer technology that we represent from Stratasys consists of two major product lines: FDM, fused deposition modeling, which is essentially a hot glue gun on steroids, using thermoplastics that extruded in a very fine layer, multiple layers, and this technology, which is used a UV-cured resin. This is what we call a brain gear. If you look at it, people say, well, that's really fun, and then I ask them, how would you make something like this using traditional manufacturing? This is printed all at once. It's all virgin material. Other 3D printer companies will talk about the accuracy of the mechanics of their system, but not the accuracy of the output part. Only way we can control that is by having virgin material, because the actual chemistry changes with the recycled material. So it has to be virgin.
Welcome back to Polk Waste Wise. Thanks for joining me today. I'm here with Anna Wood. In the first half, we were talking about recycling, and now we're going to shift gears to some garbage talk. So the holidays are approaching, and with the holidays comes wrapping paper and toy packaging and all of those things that are going to cause more trash than normal. So I want to talk to you now about throughout the month of December and into the new year, during the holiday season. The residents can have 5 bags extra in addition to their garbage cart. Elaborate on that for me and tell the residents what they're allowed to have.
Yes, that will be the case. It's up to 5 bags for garbage on service day. You can put the 5 bags near your garbage cart. Mm-hmm. And the driver will empty the cart that is full, and then he or she will then reload the cart and dump that can again.
And how are you guys keeping track of the fact that these bags are getting picked up and the service is getting done with that extra service added on to their normal?
To assure that our resident gets the level of service that they need, we have a system in place that every time the arm goes up in the garbage truck and empties the cart, it registers. It registers a number. So we know how many times a driver has serviced that specific address. So when residents call in, we can assure them that if they have the extra 5 bags, that they will do it, because we can go back and monitor and make sure that they did it. If they didn't, then we can send the hauler back to ensure that they pick up the extra 5 bags.
Well, it sounds like a convenient service for the residents.
Yes, especially now, like that. I said, you know, we have gas. We cook more, we do a lot of additional activities that generate waste, so we want to ensure that our residents have the ability of the service of not worrying about, I have too much garbage, it doesn't fit in the garbage cart, and they can put it up to 5 bags next to it.
Yes. Well, thank you, Anna, for talking about that. It's definitely going to be a helpful extra service there for the holidays. And on the next episode, the residents are going to get to meet their haulers and hear about their commitment to the service and find out who's really taking care of them. So that's all the time that we have for this episode, but you can catch this again on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday at 1:30 and 7:30 a.m. and p.m. You can also check it out on our Polk Government YouTube channel. If you have questions or comments for Polk County Waste and Recycling, you can reach out via phone or email at 863-284-4319. Or polkwastewise@polk-county.net. Also, don't hesitate to visit their website at www.polkwastewise.net for quick information related to your waste and recycling needs. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Polk Waste Wise.